obviously, because they exist today, so they had to have been aboard the Ark.
Now, what about plants? How did plants survive the flood? Because I can't imagine many plants surviving a radical change in their environment for what you say is a year.
Well, plants create seeds. That's how they propagate. So, the Earth, you know, the environment science has verified that the Earth's environment was vastly more healthy. Healthier before the flood. I mean, look, megafauna creatures, the fossils of organisms demonstrates that the life forms were huge compared to what they are today. I mean, various fossils like that have been found of all kind of various kinds of creatures. Giraffes, massive giraffes, huge. Armadillos, almost as big as one of those tiny little in Italian cars you see in the old 1960s movies. Armadillos that big. Dragonflies with wingspans of 5 feet, etc. And we verified that the Earth had far more oxygen in the past, and the fossil record shows that plant life was more prolific then. So there would have been a tremendous number of plants on the Earth before the flood, vastly much more plant life than today. So when the flood occurred, it simply buried all these seeds, trillions upon trillions upon trillions of seeds, were buried in the sediment, and after the floodwaters evaded from the Earth, the plants simply grew from seeds.
So we have insects on the Ark, and we have plants that survived the flood. Now, my question is, you know of the cheetah? When you look at the fast cat, when you look at a cheetah DNA, it shows evidence of a population bottleneck. Why do we not see evidence of a population bottleneck in every animal?
Because of the flood.
because
life was reduced to a seven of each kind, you see? They went aboard the Ark and two of each unclean kind. That's your bottleneck right there.
Yes, but when we look at other animals, we don't see the bottleneck.
Well, not every animal has exactly the same kind of DNA operations. They all have very, very much, there's a lot of similarities. But not every creature has the same genetic variability, you know, all of them, that's going to vary from one kind or one species to another. So I don't find it any kind of a problem for creation or the flood that you'll find a different genetic variability in one kind of creature than in another.
Mm.
Especially things like insects, which reproduce in vast, massive numbers compared to animals of, say, mammals, you know.
Right now,
we should expect, I think, to see a very different genetic variability in insects than mammals.
Okay, but when we look at other mammals or other closely related species, we still don't see a bottleneck.
Well, I don't, like I said, the only thing I can say about that is that this organisms, the genetic variability of organisms, it can vary between from one kind of creature to another. So I don't see how that's a problem for the creation model.
Okay, what is a kind?
Well, that's the really, evolutionists ask us this all the time, and it's really a little harder to explain than it's not like creationists can actually state this particular thing is a kind. Okay. But I would give a general description of kind as being creatures of such similarity that they are able to reproduce. Varieties within a kind represent organisms that are of the same design that are capable of reproduction. For example, there are different kinds of horse, but cat. You couldn't reproduce a cheetah with a lion. It probably would not work. You know, the organism would not be fertilized, right?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So that illustrates to us that there's God created more than one kind of cat, you see. So a kind is animals that can reproduce. Like, for example, you have a donkey and a horse can, or a mule, I forgot which it is, can reproduce and create, what is it, create a mule, donkey and a horse? Yeah, I think. So they're obviously the same kind. But the problem for evolution is that the donkey, I think, the mule is offspring, I believe. It's sterile, so it can't reproduce. See, that's a dead end for evolution right there. Evolutionists claim speciation has produced all this variety of life, but actually genetics demonstrates that there's great limits to genetic variability. I mean, to the ability of things to speciate, you know, there's limits. You get to an end somewhere, and it just, that's it. They cannot reach the kind. But I'll say there's a field of science that creationists are working on called Behrmanology, in which they are attempting to actually, with using genetics and other things, kind and morphology, attempting to recreate as many of the biblical kinds as they can, the original created kinds.
If I may jump into it, you're on to something there, Neff. That's true. At one point, what was a species? You know, the scientists had to sit down and decide, okay, this is the definition of a species. This is how we're going to define species. It's a man-made term. And as for what is a kind, that is really kind of a relatively new question that's been presented, you know, from evolutionists to the creation. Well, what's a kind? What do you call a kind? Well, to be honest, I don't know if we've ever really had to define what a kind is. So there are creationist scientists that are actually working on what defines a kind, what defines that word, what is going to be included within that, and how does that fit within the scientific community. And it just hasn't been done quite yet. So it's not exactly an answer. It's not exactly what you're probably looking for, but the truth is, just like the word species, I mean, even today, scientists still, you know, they still struggle with exactly what is a species, what isn't a species, how do we classify this, how do we classify that. The same type of process has to be done from the creationist side, and that is, what is a kind? How do we define a kind? What are we going to use for a kind, and how do we fit that into the scientific thing? So the best we can do is give you what Neff's given you from the kind definition. But until it's actually been defined later on, we can't give you that definite definition. But they are working on that particular, they are working on that definition and how to define something as a kind and what constitutes a kind. That's the best I can give you, too, from my side.
Okay, very well said.
So, if I may, if you had to guess, how many kind went on the ark?
John, you want to take that?
Yeah, sure. I don't have a clue. I couldn't even begin to guess, really. We still have to. I mean, I'm with you on the standpoint of we still have to define a kind. What exactly is a kind? I mean, from right now, I could tell you there were 1,000 kinds. Well, after we actually define a kind, maybe it was 700 kinds. Maybe it was 3,000 kinds. It's a wide target, you know. We have to define the kind first before we can actually start to give you a little bit more definite example of what it is.
In likelihood, there were thousands, actually, a few thousand at least, of kind, because of the tremendous variety of insects. There would have been far less of mammals. But, yeah, there was quite a few.
Yeah, quite a few, I know, isn't much of an exact answer for you. I'm sorry about that.
Right.
But the truth is, until they define what a kind is, we can't really take it anymore. I mean, that's the best we can give you right now.
Yeah. Okay, Q Dragon, thanks for calling in. We're going to take another call now, okay?
Oh, one more question. So let's say, for sake of argument, that there's 3,000 kinds. Do you realize how many millions of species would have to evolve from those 3,000 animals?
Yeah, I do. And first off, I don't agree that that's evolution. Speciation doesn't constitute evolutionary change because it doesn't change morphology. As you increase varieties within a kind, you don't get any change to morphology. You just get cosmetic changes such as size, color, shape, and pattern. These are not morphological differences. They're variety. Look at there's 6 billion human beings on the Earth. No two of them are just alike unless they're identical twins, right? So look at the tremendous genetic variability of humankind, mankind, you know. Take an Aborigine and a Celt, or a Chinese person and a Slav, and you compare them. I mean, they can look considerably different, right? But they're a 100% human. They all have exactly the same organs in the same location of their body plans. They have the same, all the same structures. No human being has any morphological difference from any other human being, regardless of this tremendous difference in appearance, you see. So speciation doesn't constitute evolutionary change. And so I think it's an example of actually intelligent design that life is capable of speciating like this and creating such variety that there's so much information built into the, so much variability created in the DNA recipe for a kind that that the offspring of that kind can have such a great variety, but without changing morphology. There's a limit there. Okay, thank you for calling in, Q-Dragon. We're going to take another call now. Hello, you're on the air. Somebody with a 111?
Yeah, hello?
Yes.
Can you hear me?
You're on the air. Yes, I do.
Okay, I had a question for you, actually. And my question is in regards to Brown's theory. Now, my question about that is the immense heat that would have been produced from such a theory happening. How is Noah not poached?
Hey, Evan, I'll answer that if you want me to.
Sure, go ahead, Mark.
Evolutionists say that all the floodwaters came from rain. And, in fact,
That wasn't my question, though. My question is, how is Noah not poached? I mean, if the water is coming from underneath the earth,
right?
Am I correct by assuming that because of the theory? Then how is he not poached? I'm not taking a side on where the water came from.
No, but you're asking how he didn't burn up, right? Like how he didn't.
No, how Noah didn't burn up.
That's what I'm about to answer.
All right.
The assumption in that is that it would have to rain, you know, this amount, and if it rained to cover the earth, and if it rained that much, the temperature on the earth would be, you know, just, you know, 100 degrees, for example. The problem with that is most of the water came from within the earth.
Correct.
So,
but the pressure buildup needed to shoot that water out of the earth, wouldn't that have created an immense, an immense heat? And it's sort of like when you're boiling and you have a lid on a pot.
Right.
And
no,
No,
it wouldn't have. If you'd like to know we could spend probably the next hour talking about this. What I'm going to do is I'm going to put a link in the chat. I'm going to try to put a link in the chat. Okay. So I'm going to try to put a link in the chat somehow if I can figure out how to type in here. How come I can't type in here? Anyway, I'm going to give you a link one way or the other that takes you to Brown's theory, the hydroplate theory, is actually out on the internet. If anybody would like to read it, it's all out there. The entire book is there for you to read. And in this, he actually talks about this precise question. It is under his three common questions. It is on his website under Hydroplate Overview 6. Second question is, temperatures increase with depth inside the earth. Subterranean water about 10 miles deep would have been extremely hot. Wouldn't all life on Earth have been scalded if that water flooded the Earth? Is that an accurate redepiction of your question?
Yeah, I would say that's pretty close to it.
Okay, cool. I am going to try to give you what his answer is to this, because it involves tidal pumping and a lot of other things that all kind of go back to that particular question. We can discuss it, but it's going to take an hour, and we can't do that in this call. So